Goedemorgen from the Netherlands. Welcome to the lowlands of Western Europe. I'm here in this beautiful country to learn from the masterminds of water management and explore their strategies to address sea level rise caused by climate change. The Netherlands has the world's most ambitious water management project. The American Society of Civil Engineers even calls it one of seven wonders of the modern world. But many of the existing large flood and water management structures here are designed to handle a sea level rise of up to 40 centimeters. This is risky because the Netherlands could find itself 48 centimeters underwater if sea levels rise by 84 centimeters by 2100, which UN climate scientists at the IPCC say is possible. The climate scientists also warn that a global rise of 2 meters by 2100 or even up to 5 meters by 2150 isn't out of the question due to the uncertainties about climate effects in Greenland and Antarctica. Despite these risks, the Netherlands is buzzing. It's a top spot for tourists, businesses, and migrants, known for its high quality of life, equality, and great environment for raising children. So how is the Netherlands preparing for a warmer planet and higher sea levels? Before we dive into that, let's take a look at the country's rich history of living with water. They say God made the world, but the Dutch made the Netherlands. Sounds dramatic, until you see what the Netherlands would look like without its dikes. With 26% of its land below sea level, and 60% at risk of flooding, the Dutch have been battling the forces of water for centuries. The journey from simple peat dikes to today's high-tech sensor-equipped defenses didn't happen overnight. Polders, windmills, canals, pumping stations, locks, and dams. These are some of the tools that have allowed the Dutch to reclaim about a fifth of their land from lakes and the sea. In recent years, the Dutch have continued to push the boundaries with groundbreaking projects. Take Maasvlakte 2, for instance. This expansion of the port of Rotterdam was built on land reclaimed from the North Sea, extending the territorial sea by nearly 3 miles. Then there is the sand engine, a project near The Hague where a huge amount of sand was added to the beach, extending it nearly a kilometer from the original coastline. These recent projects reflect a shift from traditional hard defenses to softer solutions. For example, the old Hondsbosse and Petermeer sea dike has been transformed into dunes, creating more opportunities for recreation and nature. Looking ahead, the Netherlands is preparing for rising sea levels. By 2035, the Dutch plan to add annually about 11 million cubic meters of sand to keep the coastline safe. If sea levels rise fast, more sand will be needed to protect the coastline. But the big question is, what about limiting greenhouse gas emissions, the main driver of sea level rise? This brings us to the Urgenda case, which is a groundbreaking legal battle that demanded the Dutch government to adopt laws and policies for more ambitious mitigation targets. The Urgenda case was the first time any court in the world ordered a government to reduce its greenhouse gas emissions based on human rights. The Urgenda Foundation brought the case, along with 889 Dutch citizens, and claimed that the Dutch government wasn't doing enough to combat climate change, a failure that could leave parts of the Netherlands underwater. They mainly argued that the government's lack of action in accordance with the best available science violated the government's duty of care under Dutch civil law and fundamental human rights, especially under the European Convention on Human Rights. The courts agreed. At every level, including the Supreme Court, the judges ruled in Urgenda's favor. They made 3 crucial points. First, they affirmed that climate change is a real and immediate threat. Examining scientific evidence, international treaties, and Dutch constitutional and civil law, they made it clear that the government had to act appropriately to protect its citizens' lives and well-being. The benchmark was clear. Emissions had to be reduced by at least 25% by 2020 compared to 1990 levels. Second, the drop in the ocean argument didn't work. Governments often claim that their emissions are too small to make a difference, like a drop in the ocean, arguing that climate change requires global collective action. The Dutch government tried this, but the courts rejected it. The judges made it clear, if countries could dodge their partial responsibilities by blaming others or pointing to their small share, no one would take action. To ensure every country is held accountable for its emissions, this defense must be rejected. Finally, the argument based on the separation of powers didn't work. The Dutch government argued that the courts were overstepping their bounds in contradiction with the separation of powers. The Supreme Court disagreed. The government's current climate policy was evidently and clearly insufficient to comply with its duties under the European Convention on Human Rights. The judges found that it is the task of the courts to provide urgenda an effective remedy. In doing so, the courts do not overstep the power that is invested in them by the Constitution. This ruling was more than just a legal victory. It was a wake-up call. Before the Supreme Court even delivered its ruling, another case was already brewing, this time targeting one of the country's biggest polluters. This case marks the first time a judge ordered a company to align its plans with the Paris Agreement on climate change. The District Court of The Hague ordered Shell to reduce its global emissions, not just those in the Netherlands, by 45% by 2030. Of course, the urgenda judgment of the Supreme Court provided a solid legal foundation for this decision. But there was also a significant factor. Shell is a carbon major. 1.8% of global greenhouse gas emissions since the 1880s can be traced back to Shell. Originally incorporated in 1890 as the Royal Dutch Petroleum Company, Shell focused on the exploration and production of oil, initially in the Dutch East Indies, which is modern-day Indonesia. In 1907, it merged with the British company Shell Transport and Trading Co., leading to the formation of the Royal Dutch Shell. As the claimants argued, today, Shell emits 9 times more greenhouse gases than the entire Netherlands put together every year. Shell has known for over 30 years that climate change is a major threat to life on Earth and decided to mislead the public and actively oppose climate policies. The CO2 emissions linked to Shell are therefore substantial, measurable, and determinable. They also matter on a global scale. The court found that Shell has a legal duty to reduce its emissions, including those from the products it sells, to help prevent a global catastrophe. The public interest in combating climate change outweighed Shell's commercial interests. Importantly, Shell's argument that if it were to draw from Nigeria, for example, other companies would simply leap in to replace it, and thus its departure would have no effect on global greenhouse gas emissions, didn't work. The court disagreed and stated that other companies have the same obligations that Shell has, so they are also responsible for reducing their emissions. After losing the case, Shell dropped Royal Dutch from its name and moved its headquarters to London. It also appealed the decision. This leaves us with many unanswered questions. What will become of the appeal? And what other climate litigation cases are unfolding in the Netherlands? With the government and oil companies now in the spotlight, the next big focus is on financial institutions, the banks and insurers backing major polluters. You might also be wondering about the Caribbean parts of the Kingdom of the Netherlands. Unlike the European part, these regions aren't covered by the Delta program. So how are they preparing for rising sea levels? And finally, will all these efforts be enough? Can humanity truly come together to reduce emissions and secure the future of our planet? Or are we on the brink of a sixth mass extinction?
The same gales that laid waste so much of Britain have taken an even greater toll of property and life in Holland. Streams of refugees leave the stricken towns and villages. More than 50,000 have already been evacuated to safe areas. Help has been offered from all over the world for Holland and for other countries hit by the flood. Already the Dutch have received £50,000 from the people of Australia. In many places, the waters are still rising, and every means of transport is used to hurry the villagers away from the advancing flood. Never in living memory have the Dutch suffered such a disaster. Yet they'll fight back, rebuild their shattered homes, and make this once more a prosperous land. But for the moment, their hopes for the future are darkened by the memory of the tragedy that has been among them. They mourn their dead, and the world joins them in their grief.